Welcome to MCN and the first generation Suzuki Hayabusa. 1999 this came out, the GSX 1300R is its official title. And not to put too fine a point on it, this bike is an icon. And the reason it's an icon, it's all about this 1300cc four-cylinder engine, just packed with grunt and packed with stories over the years, packed with folklore. Now, this is a bike that, when it came out, made a claim 173 bhp. But the big thing on it is that the speedo went up to 220 miles an hour, and early bikes would go off the clock. So even though it actually didn't do those kind of speeds, the very fact that you could go down a German autobahn and get it off the clock over 220 miles an hour made this bike very, very special. But in actual fact, every booster we've tested at MCN, from this one all the way through the second generation and the refresh, have all been restricted. They've all done around about 185, 186 mile an hour, because Suzuki had a self-imposed speed limit of 299 k's. But a few years ago, we ran one as a long-term test bike and removed the speed limiter. And at Bruntingthorpe, our speed tester, Bruce Dunn, actually got 203 mile an hour out of one. So they are properly quick and deserve their reputation. So you can see why this bike is such an icon. So it's had a lot of challenges over the years. Bikes have come and gone. Kawasaki have had the ZX12R, the ZZR 1400, there's been the Honda Blackbird, but everyone remembers the Booster. When it comes to hyperbikes, Suzuki Hayabusa is the bike you remember. And in actual fact, it's one of those bikes that back in the day you could load up with luggage, put a pillion on the back at breakfast time, and be in the south of France at tea time. So this is what they call the Generation 1 Hayabusa. It got updated in 2008, where it got more power. The power rose 194 bhp, got a few more cc's, longer stroke engine, higher compression engine, 1340cc, and it got some styling tweaks as well. Was even quicker accelerating, but that same limit on the top speed. And then in 2013, it got another minor update where it got Brembos and ABS. So over the years, Suzuki have sold over 189,000 Hayabusas. And to ride, I've ridden boosters a lot of times on different road tests. It's always been one of those bikes that always associated with big speed. We've taken them to Germany, done autobahn runs on them, taken them around the Nürburgring. And they've always been what you'd imagine, incredibly fast, really easy to gather speed just because the engines have got so much grunt. The power delivery is amazingly creamy. There's nothing like it. I mean, it's always been a big, long, low, heavy bike. So although it is quite a sporty bike and it doesn't actually mind going fast through corners, it's no short, light sports bike. But it is what it is. It is phenomenal what it does. And in actual fact, I rode it a couple of years ago with its kind of newest challenger, which was the Kawasaki H2SX. And you know, even by today's standards, this engine was better than the Kawasaki supercharged engine. It had more grunt, the power was richer, the throttle response was smoother. But of course, things have moved on a lot over the last decade, or 20 years even, since this came out. You know, braking's become better, suspension control's better, riding positions are more comfortable, you've got more electronic rider aids, more creature comforts, that kind of thing. So, you know, you can see why the Booster started to lose favor against the more modern stuff. So over the past few years, in the UK at least, the Booster disappeared, which is a massive shame. And in actual fact, Suzuki have been generally quite quiet recently, apart from the small matter of winning the MotoGP championship. But when they have produced bikes, the V-Strom, the GSX-R1000, they've maybe been a little bit conservative, especially when we're used to such kind of high-tech, whiz-bang, colourful competition. But there is going to be a new Booster for 2021, and we're going to be looking at it. We're going to be touching it, sitting on it, prodding it, starting it. And here it is, the third generation Suzuki Hayabusa. We'll be right back. I know what you're thinking. It doesn't actually look that much different to the old Boozer, does it? And I'll admit I'm a little bit disappointed. I wanted something maybe a little bit more 21st century, especially when there's so much going on with this new Boozer that's different to the outgoing model. But the more I think about it, the more I think that Suzuki have actually done the right thing. It is an evolution of the old bike. It is still a Hayabusa. And I guess you kind of got to think of it in the same sort of way as the way Porsche 911s have evolved. So it is unmistakably a Hayabusa to sit on. I've been going back and forth between the two bikes just to kind of see what the differences are. It's still very much long, low, and really heavy. It's 264 kilos, this bike, fully fueled. It's 2 kilos lighter than that one, but it's still a heavy motorbike. The riding position still feels a little bit kind of 90s in the way the seat's quite low. The pegs are relatively high. The peg position hasn't changed. But what is really good, what I really, really like, is that the handlebars are 12 mil closer, which doesn't sound a lot, but it does make a big difference. You're kind of on that one, it's a long old stretch to the bars, but on this it's much more comfortable. So motorway riding, which used to be a bit of a pain in the wrist, would be better. And the other thing that's going to make motorway riding and long distance riding a lot more comfortable is that cruise control comes as standard. So if you ever do get sore right wrist, you can take your hand off the bar to free it off. It also comes with heated grips, which is really good, but they're not standard. You've got to pay extra. When it came to designing the Hayabusa, Suzuki, their design department, created all these sketches on different shapes for the Hayabusa, and a lot of them look really, really cool, but they've gone for something that looks very, very traditional, which is good because we like what the Hayabusa looks like. But the nose is different, so it's got that kind of GSXR family nose on it, and you've got new headlights, which are a mixture of projector headlights and LEDs, but the headlights aren't cornering like some modern stuff. These running lights, LEDs, actually turn into indicators when you're riding along. And the fairing is actually much more different, actually, when you compare the two in the flesh. So you've got these more bulbous cheeks on it for aerodynamics. You've got these chrome flashes, which are pretty swish. You've got a slightly revised logo. And then working backwards, different infill panels and a different back end. So the boost is quite unique in the fact the back end's kind of quite squashed. It almost looks like a cartoon anvil has been dropped on the back suspension and it's collapsed. But that's the style, and it's aerodynamic. It's really, really aerodynamic. So it's got a new back end, and the back light cluster looks mad, like something out of a fairground ride. You've also got new 7-spoke wheels. You've got new mirrors. You've got a new screen. You've got new handlebar mountings as well, just to reduce vibes and to make things more smooth. The cockpit area, still very much Hayabusa. It's got new switch gear, kind of like the GSXR 1000s, but the clocks are still analog mainly. And I really, really love the way it's all laid out. It's very, very similar to the old bike, but it's kind of got that real industrial feel, a real kind of feel you're on something really special and something really fast. When you've got digital displays that just read out the speed you're doing, there's something a little bit sterile about it. There's something, they're just numbers, it's hard to relate to. Whereas when you've got a clock that goes round, you can kind of relate to where you are just by looking at the needle without even knowing what the numbers are. And when that needle's right over the other side of the clocks and you know you're going for it, there's something really special about that, and kind of adds to the feeling of speed you get off it as well. And there's that other thing as well, when you're a little kid and you used to look at speedos in cars and bikes and they used to go up to 150, 160 or whatever, and you used to go, wow, that's a fast car, that's a fast bike. And you get that feel here. So the Boozer's clocks no longer go up to 220, which is a bit of a shame. Wouldn't it be good if you still had 200 odd on the clock? It basically reflects what it really does. So it goes up to 180. But you've got a nice analog fuel gauge, nice analog water temperature gauge, nice analog rev counter. I really, really love it. It's really clear. All the dials are new, the digits are new, the surrounds are new. And in the middle, you've got a modern section, which is the TFT color section, which tells you all about your rider modes, all the rider information, everything you'd need to know. And talking of electronics, the Busa is absolutely packed with them now. So fundamentally, it's got a Bosch six-axis IMU and ride-by-wire for the first time. So the bike can do anything. So it's got lean sensitive traction control, lean sensitive ABS, it's got launch control, it's even got rear wheel lift control. So the traction control is 10 levels, the rear wheel lift is 10 levels. What that basically means is when you brake really, really hard, if the rear wheel starts to slip as the front's right on its nose, if it's in one of its very intrusive modes, the bike will just brake very flat. It will never let you kind of endo, if you know what I mean. And it does that basically by letting the brakes off. So braking power isn't going to be as much as it could be in one of its intrusive rear wheel lift mode. And it will be more impressive with everything switched off, more for kind of track riding. It's also got a speed limiter, which is quite handy. It's quite easy to accidentally nibble over the speed limit on this bike. And hill hold control, which isn't that necessary, but it's nice to have. So what is the Hayabusa going to be like when you give it some of that? Well, it's got ride-by-wire now, so let's hope it's smooth. Some previous Suzuki models like the Katana GSXR1000 aren't that smooth when you pick up a closed throttle. There's a bit of a jerk. It should have more mid-range. Suzuki claim more mid-range oomph, like between 4 and 6,000 RPM, which is exactly what you're going to be using on the road. So the Hayabusa should feel faster, should feel more responsive. So it won't feel like it's lost anything. But in actual fact, it has, because of Euro 5, because of the way the engine's been retuned, and it's more about the mid-range grunt. It's come down slightly in top-end BHP, so it's down from 194 BHP to 187, and peak torque is down from 114 pound-foot to 111. Will you actually notice that? I very, very much doubt it. Will it be important when you're bragging online and in internet forums? Maybe, but in the real world, it won't make any difference. The boost is still gonna feel amazing, I hope. The mid-range and the grunt and the fluidity of the engine, I really hope still gonna be there. The other thing, ironically, because it's now Euro 5, which is all about emissions regulation, it's worse on fuel claimed. So the old bike Suzuki claimed did 50 miles per gallon. Now it's down to 42. So that's quite a big reduction. So that means that out of this 20 litre tank, you should get around about 176 miles. Suzuki have experimented with different engine configurations for the Busa, and they even tried a six-cylinder turbocharged engine. Why didn't they use that? I mean, fancy telling someone you've got a six-cylinder turbo. Now, during testing, they actually found that the inline four was the better solution for the Busa, and they're probably right, but it would have been nice to have something a bit madder, wouldn't it? The only external difference in really, you've got the inline four engine, same capacity. The only real big difference, the way to look at it, is the exhaust. So it's Euro 5 friendly. You've got an elliptical cat in the exhaust collector box, and then you've got a round cat in each one of these crazy looking end cans. So this is an anorax guide to the Busa engine. Now Suzuki have done a lot of work to this engine to put it through Euro 5, to make it smoother, to give it more grunt. So virtually every single part inside this inline four has been tweaked. So we've got a new cylinder head with new combustion chamber, new cams, new cam tensioner, new valve springs, crank, pistons, gearbox, oil ways have all been changed. It's got a new slip and assist clutch, smaller throttle bodies. Normally they grow, don't they? They're down from 44 to 43 millimeters. The intake trumpets have been extended by 12 mil. You've got new twin injector system in the throttle bodies, bigger airbox, new ram air, new radiator, and Suzuki's are bomb-proof anyway, aren't they? I mean, Suzuki engines are the darling of the drag race world, but the Suzuki engine in this is even more durable, and even the way it's been screwed together in the factory has changed just to give it a little bit more life. Ride, the new Busa should be largely the same as the old one, mainly because the frame is almost identical. Same swing arm, same frame, extruded aluminium, same subframe. It's got a different seat rail on it, which saves a tiny little bit of weight, but the character of the bike shouldn't be too different. And that's no bad thing. It's extremely stable, this bike, in a straight line and round really fast corners. It absolutely monsters motorway corners and fast A roads. Not so nimble, but it is what it is. You know, it's a very stable bike. It's not designed to scratch through B roads. The suspension is the same as before, KYB shock and forks, but the internals have been revised. So hopefully the ride quality would be a little bit plusher and there'll be a little bit more control when you're pushing on. The other thing to mention, really, we're very obsessed with power figures and weight figures. As I said before, this is a heavy bike, but the good thing about heavy bikes and the thing that makes this feel so special is that heavy bikes just iron out bumps. They just trample over bumps like they're not there. So you should still get that exquisite feeling of unflappability, if that's even a word, when you're riding this fast cross country. So how's it going to grip and how's it going to stop? Well, it's got new tyres, Bridgestone S22 tyres. Now they're all-round sports tyres, very, very, very good tyres. These are OE spec, so these are made for this bike. Has to be said, sometimes OE spec tyres are very good. They're as good as the replacements, and sometimes they're not very good. So only time's gonna tell when we come to ride this bike how good the tyres are. But if they're anywhere near as good as the proper S22s, you'll have no problems with them at all. Braking should be better as well. One of the massive weak points of the old Busa that we really noticed when I rode against that Kawasaki H2SX was how poor the brakes were, shockingly bad. Now this has got different brakes. So this has got Brembo Stylomers. So the Stylomers came out a couple of years ago on the Panigale V4, really racy calipers. And the discs are up from 310 mil to 320 mil. So you've got all the makings of this having the stopping power to match the engine power. But the only thing I would say is the hardware doesn't tell the full story. Sometimes braking power isn't as good as it could be because of the way the ABS is set. So for example, the GSXR1000's brakes aren't brilliant just because the brake by wire of the ABS system doesn't let it perform as well as it could. So again, only time will tell, and a decent ride on this bike, how good the brakes will actually be. One final thing to add is the Busa's balance. This has been one of its strong points, really, is just how predictable the bike is and how well balanced it is. And it's even better balanced now because it's now got a 50-50 weight distribution. One of the reasons it should be better balanced is because the exhaust is a little bit lighter at the back here. and it represents sort of most of the 2 kilo weight saving overall. So because the back end's lighter, now it's got a perfect 50-50 weight distribution. So there you have it, the third generation Suzuki Hayabusa. It's going to be out very, very soon. Suzuki haven't announced any official prices yet, but we'd expect this to cost around about the same as an entry-level superbike. So if you kind of think GSXR 1000R, a normal R1, ZX10, that kind of thing. It's not going to be kind of superbike territory. So the only thing left for us to do now, after all of that talking, is to go out and ride it.